Okay, hi friends. This is Brother Mike. Sunday morning. Welcome, saints. Welcome to the Deep Things of God with Brother Mike. Every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, you can catch me on twitch.tv. You can catch me on Twitter. You just put in the codes HCCADC, House Hardcore Christianity, Arizona Deliverance Center, and you're there. I'm also on my Facebook page, broadcasting on Michael W. Smith on Facebook. And the purpose of the Sunday morning broadcast is to teach you things that you will never hear in church. These are things that are not taught in church, but are taught in God's Word. And they're very important. And these are things you need to have if you are contemplating going into the ministry, if you're contemplating a ministry of healing and deliverance, if you truly want to help people and pull them out of the fire, as the apostle said. These teachings are very important. You can contact me on mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Remember that we have two Zoom deliverance services every week, Tuesday night at 6 o'clock Mountain Time, and then Wednesday night at 6 o'clock Mountain Time. You can send me an email and get the ID code and the password. I'll send it right out to you. If you need a religious exemption, send me an email. I'll send that right out to you. If you know someone that needs deliverance and they can't come to the Zoom broadcast, they can't come to Phoenix to the Deliverance Center, send me an email. I'll send you out the miracle list, a step-by-step guide that works 100% of the time. I have one for troubled Christians. I have one for mentally ill Christians. Okay. I am one of the foremost counselors in the entire country, Christian counselors, I should say, in the field of healing and deliverance for mentally ill Christians. If there's somebody else doing this similar to me, I'm unaware of it. I wrote a book on it. It's on the website. You can get it off there. It's called The Root Cause and Cure of Mental Illness. You'll be shocked at the information in that book. I also have case studies from my personal counseling practice and from the Word of God. So today I wanted to talk to you about the will of God and what He wants to do with your life. He wants to do several important things. And the problem is nobody actually believes Him because they don't understand Him. God has a personality just like you and I do. He has His own distinct personality. Father has one. The Son has one. The Holy Ghost has one. They all have separate and distinct personalities. And as a result, they have what I call a personality temperament. How that personality reacts and relates to the outside world. And people don't understand that God is love. That's what the Apostle John taught us. And he should know. He knew the Lord Jesus better than anyone. God is love. Now, how does that actually translate into your life? What are you going to be doing with your life as a result of that? Well, here it is. You've got to understand how this thing works for you personally. How does it work for humanity globally? And it's easy to see in the Word of God. Take a look at Matthew chapter 18, verse number 14. And Jesus is talking about human beings. He's talking about children. He's talking about people that are lost. Lost sheep is the illustration here. And it says here, quote, Jesus said, "It is not the will of your Heavenly Father that one of these little ones should perish." You remember the story everybody has of the parable of the lost sheep. It is not God's will that one person, one human being, perish. It is not His will. If you turn to 2 Peter chapter 3 and check out verse 9, more shocking material representing, illustrating, highlighting God's personality. It says, quote, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but he is long-suffering to us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." That's a shocking statement there, because you have all kinds of religious theories and theologies out there that are half-baked and crackpot, that God doesn't want to heal some people. He wants some people to die and go to hell. He wants some people to die and go to heaven. He's picked out these people before they were born, blah, 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 blah. Okay, the Word of God does not support those lies. Here's what it supports. God is long-suffering to us. He's very patient. He is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So in your ministry, you've got to understand that when you're working with someone, the will of God is on your side. God's attitude is with you. He wants to help that person. He cares about them. He likes helping people. It's part of his personality. It's part of his personality temperament. He likes to help people. He feels good about it. He's happy doing it. And that's why it says he wants everyone to come to repentance, which is part of the Great Commission. In the last chapter of Luke, you'll notice that Jesus said he wanted repentance and forgiveness of sins preached in his name to all nations. That means that God is not willing that any should perish, that includes you, but all should come to repentance. Now remember, if you're in the deliverance ministry or the healing ministry, repentance is essential, because chronic sin and hidden sin and iniquity in the heart. I explained this on a couple of podcasts ago. A person who sins, for example, steals something, that's a behavioral sin. But the sin of stealing is an iniquity that was inside the person before they stole. So your iniquity in your heart leads you to commit sins. The iniquity is already there, or you wouldn't do it. Yeah? For example, I do not have any iniquity in my heart to steal things. And as a result of that, I never steal anything. I don't go around stealing things. I don't feel comfortable with it. It's not part of me, because I don't have any theft iniquity inside me. Okay? Everything that you are as a person is first inside you in the form of iniquity, and is expressed as sin. Fear, lust, stealing, lying. It's all in here first. And so God is saying clearly here, if you be willing to come to repentance, God is on your side. He's in favor of it. He wants you to do that so you can be saved. And he's patiently waiting for you, long-suffering. The Greek word means to be patient. He's patiently waiting for you to change. And he has been waiting for you to change for years. And only patience, love, and grace would allow him to wait this long for you to change. You should have changed years ago, and you know it, but you didn't. But judgment has not fallen on you, because God doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants everyone to come to repentance. Check this out. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. It says, God who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth, that there is one God and one mediator between God and men, Jesus Christ the Lord. 1 Timothy chapter 2 specifically says, don't ever get involved in any kind of Darwinism or false fake teachings like that. That is total delusions. It's demonic. Darwinism is a lie. Trash it. Here's what you should believe. Listen to the word of the Lord. God's will is what? Who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, that there is one God and one mediator between God and man, Jesus Christ. The Greek word for will there in that verse is thelo, and it means wants to. God wants to have all men saved. Okay, the Greek word for all there is pas. It means everybody, everyone to be saved. The Greek word for saved there is sozo, delivered. God wants everyone to be delivered and come to the knowledge of the truth. Here's the number one truth. There's one God, one mediator between God and man. It is God the Son. It couldn't be any clearer. It could not be any clearer. This is what God wants to do. So if you're in the ministry, you've got the upper hand. You're in the driver's seat. God is already on your side. And the answer is yes. He wants this person healed. He wants that person delivered. He wants to help you. Couldn't be any clearer. Why? Because God's a good God, the Bible says. God is love. That's how it works. That's how it works. I have worked with people, believe it or not, For years. Okay, I've been a counselor for 40 years. I got the patience of Job. I've worked with people for years waiting for them to come to repentance and acknowledging truth. I literally have people on my counseling staff. I have a staff of counselors at the Arizona Deliverance Center. And one of the counselors on the staff, I waited for 12 years to come. 12 years, I met this person years ago. They would not repent. They would not change. And every once in a great while, I would drop them a note. I would send an email, some little thing like that. Just little drops over the years, you know. And the person finally came. And now is doing a fantastic job counseling and delivering people at the Deliverance Center. I have been working with some people for a decade, waiting for them to come to repentance and to acknowledge truth. And yeah, I have had a lot of failures. That's correct. I have in my office a list of people, literal list, filling the page of dead people, people who have died, who would not change, they would not listen. End of story. And they're dead. Okay. Yeah, I've lost some people. And through patience, some have finally come around. But I knew that God was going to forgive them. I knew that God had grace for them and for all their sin. And they're hardcore sinners, all of it. But I knew because of God's word that there was a possibility they could repent and come back. Last Friday night at my service, I had an altar call and a guy came down the front for prayer who can't stand me. Hadn't seen the guy in months and he just dropped in. His demons told him to drop in and criticize me. This was at the altar where other people are praying to be healed and delivered. This guy's wanting to criticize me at the altar. Okay. You know, so I just blew it off, switched the subject and moved on. But the point is, some people, they will not change no matter what. They will not change. I have a woman with schizophrenia I've been working with for, I think, 6 years. And I have another one who has schizophrenia I've been working with for, I believe, 9 years or 10 years. And the first one I just mentioned comes in and gets tremendous deliverance. I mean, she has a legion of demons. They come out in layers, and I mean hundreds come out in every session. But as we get down to the rebellion demon, all schizophrenics have a horrible rebellion demon. As we get closer to that demon, he then pitches a fit. And this woman turns on me and disappears, and I don't see her for 12 or 24 months. Gone. And then she sends a bunch of derogatory, nasty, hateful emails, you know. And then 12 or 24 months, she pops in again. And I reboot it. Okay, let's go. Let's go back to the love of God. Let's go back to grace. Now, you got to repent. And as soon as she does, the grace of God does it again. Drives out the spirits. Okay. I have another schizophrenic I've been working with, I think, for 10 or 11 years. And she has monstrous fear spirits, fear demons. And I hear from her every 6 or 8 months. I had her scheduled for an appointment again to come in for prayer. She no-showed at that appointment. Fear got her again. And I said, well, okay, we'll just let it go. Patience is worth it, because you will be pulling some out of the fire. You're going to pull some people out of the fire. But understand and know that the grace of God and the love of God is always available for you. No matter what you've done, no matter how bad your sin is, the grace of God is always there. What is the purpose of God with your life? Couldn't be any clearer. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. Through death, Jesus might destroy him that had the power of death. That is, the devil. And to deliver them who through the fear of death were all their life subject to bondage. Now let's break that verse down quickly. Through death, Jesus might destroy, the Greek word is katergeo, it means to abolish or wipe out the devil. Because the devil has the power of death. The Greek word is kratos. Kratos means the dominion, the domination of death. He has control of it. And you can tell by looking at our world, death is his specialty. It's his specialty. And the purpose of God was sending Jesus to wipe him out and deliver them who through the fear of death were all their lives subject to bondage, Greek word dulia, slavery. That's the purpose of God, is to wipe out the devil in your life. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14 and 15, it specifically says it right there. 1 John chapter 3, couldn't be any clearer. Verse 8, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. The Greek word for destroy there is luo, which means to untie or unchain or unloose. Luo. Deo is the opposite. Tie it You're tied up. You're chained up. The purpose of the Son of God, it specifically says it right here, 1 John 3:8, was to loose the works of the devil. What works? The damage he's caused to you emotionally and mentally and physically and spiritually. All the damage he's done to you and your family, you and your friends, to your finances, to your career, to your marriage, to your children. He swept through your life and had a finger in every bad thing you can imagine. These are his works. That's what he does. That's what he's supposed to do. That's how he rolls. But the purpose of the Lord Jesus was to loose you from all of these bondages. All of it. And in the end, you will be loosed from the bondage of death through eternal life and the rapture and a new resurrected body similar to the one that Jesus has. You are not going to die. You are going to have eternal life. You are going to live forever. Check out the Great Commission. Not for us. That's at the end of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But the Great Commission that God gave Jesus. Jesus was on the Great Commission from Father. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Jesus quotes Isaiah chapter 61. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor." That's the Greek word, euangelion. It means glorious good news. He has anointed me to preach good, wonderful news to the poor. The poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. That's the Greek word, suntribo. It means people who are shattered, emotionally shattered, the mentally ill, the emotionally ill, the heartbroken. That's what God was sent to do. That's why Jesus came. He was anointed to heal your broken heart. He was anointed to, quote, preach deliverance to the captives. The Greek word for deliverance there is aphesis. It means freedom. Like somebody walking out of jail for the first time in 20 years. They have this enormous sense of freedom come over them. He preaches deliverance, freedom to the captives, and to recover sight to the blind. That's not just physical, it's spiritual. Blind people can be physically and spiritually blind. And it says he also was anointed to set at liberty, same Greek word as deliverance previously, aphesis, to set at liberty, to set free those that are bruised. You can be physically bruised. You can be emotionally bruised. You can be mentally bruised. And the anointing of Christ was to set you free from these things. And it says, he sent me to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And that year is 2022. That year is now. You have a chance to be free now and free of all these things that Jesus mentioned and the prophet mentioned in Isaiah 61. During their evangelistic crusades in the book of Acts, an amazing statement was made about Jesus by the saints. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. It is the theme of our ministry, HardcoreChristianity.com. It says, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. He went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Kata dunastuo is the Greek word for oppression. It means to dominate, to beat down, to control through intimidation. Kata dunastuo, domination. That is the purpose that Jesus came, to relieve you of this demonic, satanic oppression that has attacked your life. You can be free of it. Now, notice something funny in this verse here. It's very interesting. It says, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and dunamis, power, and power. Do you notice those two are separated? Yeah, because most Christians, all Christians, all born-again Christians actually, have the Holy Ghost, but few have Holy Ghost power. What are you talking about? In order to develop the dunamis power of the Holy Ghost, it has to be exercised, used, applied. You have to practice the anointing. And most Christians won't do that. They just want somebody to pray for them. They just want to sit there and do nothing. If you want to have a Holy Ghost ministry, you have to step out by faith and practice that anointing. You have to release that anointing. See that? Having the Holy Ghost isn't good enough. You need Holy Ghost power, dunamis power. And the only way to do that is to develop it. And the Holy Ghost, teaches you and trains you how to develop that power. Well, Jesus had both. He had the Holy Ghost without measure, John chapter 3, and he had dunamis power from the Holy Ghost without measure. And that's how he performed all those spectacular, incredible miracles in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It was absolutely amazing. His dunamis Holy Ghost anointing and his supernatural power was hard to believe. It was off the hook, literally great. And so you need to have both the Holy Spirit and Holy Spirit dunamis power. And that way you will be able to help people who are being oppressed, beaten down, pounded down, hammered down by the devil. It couldn't be any clearer in the world, in the Word. Couldn't be any clearer. And if you'll notice, Jesus went through his ministry, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, doing exactly that. I'll give you an example. Matthew chapter 4, verse 24. So they brought to him all the sick people that were taken with diseases, torments, possessed with devils, lunatics, palsy, and he healed them all. Why? Because he had the Holy Ghost and the dunamis power of the Spirit without measure. And so in America, Satan's strategy against Christians is brilliant, literally brilliant, because he fills them up with so many things to do during the day, and they're so busy during the day, and they're so tired at the end of the day that they don't have any time to develop their dunamis. And so they just continue on as a Christian with the Holy Spirit, but having no real effect of healing and deliverance on anybody around them. They're just constantly riding the bus, but they never get off. But Jesus got off the bus. Here you can see it. He handled people who came to him. They brought everyone to him who had diseases. That's a Greek word, nosos. It means some kind of a sickness that got into your body. It's a physical illness. It says he healed the people that were in torments. Basanos is the Greek word there. It means to be tortured. To be tortured, you know, like the CIA tortures people, like Saddam Hussein used to torture Shia Muslims. Remember that? Torture. That's what the devil does. He tortures people with what? Physical illnesses, mental illnesses, emotional illnesses, finances, mental illnesses, depression, anxiety. That's it. Those are his works. That's the symptoms of demons. Matthew 4:24 says he was healing people who were possessed with devils. Greek word daimonion means demons. And the Greek word for possessed there is daimonizomai. It means to be under the control of a spirit to a greater or lesser extent. It's a sliding scale word. Daimonizomai. It doesn't mean to be possessed like, you know, the exorcist. People can be daimonizomai. Demonized is a better term to use. And not be possessed. Okay. By the way, Christians can't even be possessed. That's not even possible. The Holy Spirit lives in the spirit man. The demons can't get into the spirit man. So they can't possess a Christian. That's not possible. But humans can be possessed, no question. I've seen possessed humans. I've done street ministry before. I used to have a jail ministry. I used to have a prison ministry. I used to minister at the state hospital in Arizona. I've seen possessed people. Christians cannot be possessed, but they can be demonized or under the control of a spirit. They can be infected with a spirit in their body, causing a physical illness, or in their brain, causing a mental illness. That's true, but they're not possessed. That's not how it works. Then it says Jesus was healing people who were lunatics. Okay. Seleniazomai is the Greek word. It technically means to be moonstruck. The theory was thousands of years ago that whenever there was a full moon, people would mentally go crazy, and they called them lunatics later. Okay. What was really happening was that the demons in the brain of the patient would manifest tremendously during a full moon, trying to get people to think that the moon had something to do with it. It has nothing to do with it. It's all demons. Now, these lunatic spirits, they are extremely powerful. These are the demons that cause autism, you know, mental retardation, Down syndrome, you know, pre-existing disabilities in the womb. Severe psychosis, severe mental illness. In Arizona, we call them SMIs, the severely mentally ill. These are superpower demons, like on steroids, that are capable of causing tremendous disabilities. Seleniazomai. They're deaf and dumb spirits, and they're spirits on steroids, and they're superpowered demons. The last one he said that he healed was the palsy, paralyticus, which means someone who had a spinal cord injury. And if you had a spinal cord injury, you can still be healed. Okay? But you have to have the Holy Ghost, and you must develop your dunamis, your power, in order to be able to help people in a similar fashion to Jesus. You don't just suddenly wake up Tuesday and, oh, hey, I've got all this power. I'm going to go out and save the world. It doesn't work like that. It's a growth system. If you look back over the great faith healers, Catherine Kuhlman, Wigglesworth, John Lake, Sister Etter, all those are the superstars. They never started out like that. They were all trained. They were all led through a process of learning. They all developed enormous patience and endurance. And they kept going, even though the devil threw everything at them but the kitchen sink. And their lives were tormented, and they were facing enormous hurdles in life. They kept persevering, And as they went, they developed their dunamis power. And at the result of that was they were capable of, through the grace of God, enormous capacities for healing and deliverance. Wigglesworth, for example, had enormous power over demons. These lunatic demons I mentioned that Jesus were casting out, he had the capacity to cast those out. Most people do not. It takes years to develop your dunamis. And the point simply being, you need to get started right now. You got to hit this thing more than a lick. You got to go after it. And God is calling you to go after it. He doesn't want you just sitting in a church, ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. That's not God's will. God's will is for you to become a warrior. And you are to do what Paul told Timothy. I want you to war a good warfare. God wants you ready to go. And in order to do that, you have to understand that it is God's will to heal. It's God's will to deliver. God's a good God. God is love. And grace applies to your situation and the situation of the others, of others that you are trying to help. Now, can everybody be healed? No. Why is that? Because repentance won't occur in everyone. Everyone has free will, and you don't have control over somebody else's free will. You don't have that. You can't control someone else's free will, and God will not control it. He refuses to do it. The devil would be happy to do it. He'll lie to you, cheat you, goad you, push you. He'll do anything to get you to turn over your free will to him. Your Heavenly Father will not do that. The Holy Ghost waits for you to voluntarily give him your free will. And so you have to be deadly serious, because now we've only got a few years left till the rapture hits. Everybody can see it. There isn't anybody that can't see it now. You got to have your ostrich head in the sand not to see it. The judgments in Revelation, the prediction in the Revelation that the river Euphrates would dry up. Do you remember that? It's actually happening. The river Euphrates is at record low levels. It's drying up. It's happening right now. You remember in Revelation 18 about the city of Babylon? It's being rebuilt right now. Do you remember the predictions in Revelation about the fourth temple? The Jews have the plans for the fourth temple right now. They're going to take over the mount, and they're going to rebuild the Jewish temple. They're planning on it right now. All of these things are happening right in front of our eyes. Boom. It's right there. And you only have a few years left, and you've got to make the best of it. Because you have one life, you will not get another. Reincarnation is a lie. When you die, you do not come back as anything or anybody else. You take to heaven what you have done, and you are judged at the judgment seat of Christ for what you've done. That's it. Nothing can change it. So right now, in Jesus' name, you are going to make major changes in your life, and you are going to use the love of God and the purpose of Christ to destroy the works of the devil, and you're going to use them for the rest of your life. You are not going to waste your life anymore. You're not going to die and nothing and nobody. It is not going to happen. The rest of your family's already died. They died, and they were nothings and nobodies spiritually. You already saw them die. They amounted to nothing. That is not you. You are not going to die with nothing. And you are not going to die a nobody. Period. Send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. I'll send you the miracle list. I'll send you a religious exemption. Every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock is my podcast for the saints of God. The Deep Things of God with Brother Mike. Please remember, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, our Zoom deliverance services. Send me an email. I'll send you the ID code and the password. We have two live services in Phoenix at the Deliverance Center every Thursday and Friday at 7 p.m. Mountain Time. That service, both of them, are broadcast on our YouTube teaching channel and four other platforms. Just go to youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. There are also four other platforms we're broadcasting it on, and we load it up on four more platforms the following day. So the Thursday night teaching with Brother Rick and the deliverance service is loaded up on four other platforms the next day. My service on Fridays, same thing. All right, so the services are there, the teaching's there. You must learn spiritual warfare, and you've got to break out of this slump, okay, without condemning yourself. And everybody, 100% of all Christians, no matter who they are, no matter how powerful they are, it doesn't matter, everybody goes through slumps. Everyone. I've been through several over the years. Everybody has bad things happen to them. Bad things have happened to me. It's unbelievable. Sometimes you just got to laugh at it, because if you don't, it'll get you down. But by faith, you learn to overcome your temptations and trials. You learn to overcome the pressure that the devil's going to put on you. I want to warn you about something. If you decide to turn your life over to the Lord and not just be a church Christian — we don't need any more church Christians. They're literally useless. They're all over the country. They represent 99% of all Christians in America. They're just church Christians. They couldn't pray their way out of a wet paper bag, couldn't cast a demon out of somebody if their life depended on it. They don't know nothing. You are not called to do that. You are called to be a fighter. You are to war a good warfare. Okay? You are to put on the whole armor of God. That's a fight. You are to be a fighter. Okay? You are not to be an amateur boxer for the rest of your life. When I was young, I was an amateur boxer off and on for about 10 years. And I was started out as a welterweight. I finished up as a light heavyweight when I was in college. And I learned in boxing, there are levels to fighters. And in all the gyms I worked out in over the years, I would run into world-class amateur fighters, professionals, world champions, GOATs. Everybody's at another level. You can't just say you're a boxer and know anything about the person. Well, you can't say you're a Christian and know anything about a person, because everybody has a different anointing. Wigglesworth is a Christian, and your pastor's a Christian. Well, there's no comparison between your pastor and Smith Wigglesworth, even though they're both Christians. There was no comparison between me as a welterweight boxer when I was young. You know, I think I was in 9th or 10th grade. And Sugar Ray Robinson, the greatest boxer that ever lived. Okay, there's a big gap there. There's a pretty big gap there. Okay, it's huge. Same thing is true spiritually. You cannot just be called a Christian or live a Christian. That's not going to work. Okay? God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. He went about doing good, healing all those who were oppressed of the devil. And now it's your turn. Okay? You got to learn spiritual warfare. Okay? You don't learn it from word of faith garbage. You learn it from actually doing it. Actually doing it. Okay? You can be the most amazing word of faith person in the world and see the Holy Ghost not move at all. Have you ever tuned in to one of these word of faith crackpots? There's no moving of the Holy Ghost. Nobody's getting healed. Nobody's getting delivered from demons on these shows. You haven't watched them? I've watched them all. Creflo Dollar, T.D. Jakes, you know, all the whole crew. Okay. You got to learn to exercise your dunamis to become a very dangerous person in the spirit world. That's what God's calling you to do. You are supposed to be a dangerous person in this world. Right? HardcoreChristianity.com is the website. Please go there. I've got some tremendous teachings on that website. Some of them are real short. They're very informative. Please come to the Deliverance Center in Phoenix if you have an opportunity on Thursday and Friday night. If you don't, please hit the Zoom services on Tuesday and Wednesday. We got people being delivered and healed on these Zoom services you wouldn't even believe. Last thing I want to mention is that I do have a special program where I will do a Zoom teaching question and answer period at your church or your home group. Okay, just contact me, mike@hardcorechristianity.com, and I will set it up, and we will have a group meeting with you and your people, and we'll be able to answer questions about deliverance. I love these sessions because I always get good questions. I'm having one later today, for example, with a group in Arkansas. So if you need a group Zoom, you can schedule a time with me. I'll be happy to join you and help in any way I possibly can. Today we're going to say to the devil, hasta la vista, baby.